hero against Spiritbreaker for one, because it slows you quite a lot. The armor is pretty good against the slow hitting physical damage of Ehome. Like, I think the Frost armor is actually going to be especially good this game. And if you look at Ehome's lineup, actually, they don't have the best tower aggressors. Like, EG can just hold on forever by just baiting them into getting further and further, and then Universe, if he gets a Blink Dagger, there's just the potential for absolute chaos there. And so I really like EG's lineup. And I'm not just saying that because I think they'll win this game, but I think their lineup is really well balanced, and I expect Sumail to have a good game. Like, if Sumail has a good game here, then EG, they should be able to snowball off of this. Because look at Ehome's draft. Like, they have really greedy supports. Lion is a hero that has to get a Blink Dagger to succeed against a Storm Spirit, and it looks like he's going to have to play a 5-position Lion to begin with.
Want to welcome everybody in from the stream now, who's now tuning in to our commentary. I'm sure the beautiful panel that we have, the beautiful people there, gave some very professional analysis on the draft. Blitz and I had a much more fun time during our draft, but
if you want the real talk,
it does end up exactly what you were talking about. What's the real talk, Blitz?
If you want the real talk, just listen to our draft analysis.
Yes, if you want the real talk, if you ever want to hear Blitz and I, just listen to us during the drafting phase when we're on the mainstream.
Yeah, we do some clown stuff, but all right. So
the
EG,
battle begins.
Okay, I think that you put PVD
stupendous.
In regardless of what happens, I guess Fear is better suited for top, just because he has Blink, right? And there's no reliable stun from Ehome. Yeah. But he's still gonna struggle in this matchup. Like, Undying is just such an annoyingly powerful hero.
Yeah, and it's just the danger of the Spirit Breaker. Like, even if you blink away, if he's charging you, like, he's going to be able to charge you underneath the tower. So you've really got to be careful with the constant harassment of the Undying, and as he brings you lower and lower, Spirit Breaker just may make that full committal. And it's not like tower is even that much of a savior. Spirit Breaker has such high effective HP versus physical damage.
Yeah, and Sumail actually, he's the type of player that's just going to get in CTY space and spam out that that spell right here, and he knows that CTY can't CS from the spike. Look, he's just giving him the right click nonstop. Like, I think he even dropped a remnant there.
Yeah, he almost overcommitted there. That was a really good play from Sumail, reading that opportunity, knowing, okay, he's gonna come back. He really needs this last hit,
denied.
But if he actually misses it, I can easily get the kill. Sumail is gonna drop him once again. CTY is just being forced to burn through these tangos, and is missing so much CS in the meantime.
Yeah, this is why the matchup is so difficult. If the Storm just decides to play up on you at all times, it's really hard for the Bloodseeker to respond with anything. And you notice that Sumail doesn't even bother going for denies or anything like that. He's just trying to pressure him as much as possible. Like, he steps forward like that, even if he has no kill potential, just to zone him out. And enough about the intricacies of the Storm Spirit matchup, because nobody cares about that. But the ward actually gets eaten. All right, it's just like a ward-eating frenzy at bottom. It just, like, traded sentries like crazy. That was really weird.
AUI is still sticking around. This is the thing that we're talking about earlier, is that the Bounty Hunter being able to put pressure on the supports so easily, especially in dual lane scenarios. So now that they've killed all the countervision, DDC is going to have a difficult time dealing with this. BPD is actually going to run into him, and we'll be able to get a lot of right-click damage, but of course with Razor coming out, he's going to still play careful. This does leave the Queen of Pain solo up in there, the top lane, as we were talking about before. Or Spirit Breaker. Actually find an Invis rune, so maybe they can find an opportunity to go on Fear. He's only sitting on 435 max HP right now.
Yeah, he's really struggling against this lane, and we expected that though, right, to begin with? Because
watch the first
him dying. No 17%. There's no way. He would have to bash him like four times, and then Fear would have to blink within vision to continue the charge. It's really unlikely they kill him, but being annoying, yeah, they can accomplish that really easily.
Sumail gonna do some bottle throwing here, just really ensure he can keep the pressure up on CTY. As you can see, CTY's multiply dropping down below. And I think a big part of this is, again, what we talked about earlier, is the fact that no one from the side lanes is dropping any HP.
Yeah, and it's more just that CTY can't get enough creeps in a row to be able to get CS. And now you're seeing the advantage, 18 CS to 7. If you're a Storm, you want at least, like, getting 30 by 5 minutes means that you're guaranteeing yourself, if you want a treads and a bottle, by the time nighttime is halfway over, meaning that pretty much everybody is ready.
Oh, nice. Sumail just got that deny on CTY. He was going for the Blood Rite kill. The great top lane, they make it a big dive, and they will be able to pick up the first
mid as well.
Nice pick up, and CTY also dies in middle. Sumail's able to force that one out.
Oh,
rough time. for these lanes. Mail now brings back his bottle. C2Y is just completely stuck out of this now. With Sumail about to pick up level 6, I'm not sure how he's ever going to be able to pick up more CS. Do you think like a health potion would have actually made a difference there for the Bloodseeker in the phase, being able to rapidly get up the full HP? Because what you were saying there is, like, he couldn't get enough CS in a row to be able to continue his snowball. You're basically saying he couldn't get up the full HP, right? And in order to make sure he felt comfortable every CS pushing forward. Is that part of that, the Tango, the slow buildup of HP from Tango just isn't good enough?
No, I think it more has to do with the fact that C2Y's getting hit by too many times. It's not even like the activation time is too short for you to dodge it. It's just hitting him too many times. I know I'm focusing a lot on this shit matchup, and it's not just because it's a Storm Spirit. It's more just the fact that C2Y is now died in a one-on-one matchup that you shouldn't die in. Like, in most 1v1 matchups, this is going to be constructed very hard.
It's a little awkward. Sumail does get hit. The silence, they do pick up the kill before AUI can actually stop it with the Burrow Strike. And now with three heroes and the Vision, they'll get on top of AUI for a double kill. CTY, that was huge. Great rotation now from E-Home that now puts CTY in a much better position he was just 30 seconds prior. So Evil Genius is just a little bit too late on their rotations to save their mid. Meanwhile, the top lane bottom is perfectly fine to stay solo against Fear as
Radiant's
the Undying.
How's
that bottom lane going?
Attack.
We haven't really talked too much about that. It's been the Lich just bringing the lane back constantly for Universe's Sin King. Still, though, YJ is getting, it seems, a decent amount of farm. 15-1. You gotta count those free denies from the Lich in there, so his CS really isn't bad.
Yeah, considering the circumstances, it's not bad, but Lich is doing what Lich is meant to do. It's not that, you're just trying to slow down the Razor from as much farm as possible. You don't even have to really harass him. It's just about slowing down his farm and taking away the potential amount of creep that he can possibly get. That's so huge for him. So the Razor is doing okay, but the Lich is just making things so annoying. And Universe is the type of player, too, that you want to set up.
They find this one. They're going to be able to get the charge. The silence is on top of the Hex. Yep. They will be able to control some mail for a decent amount of time. Still, the bot line. Oh my god, 11 HP. Rupture's now put on him. Sumail is desperately trying to bottle up, and he will have enough HP plus the rotations from Evil Geniuses that CTY cannot make the full commitment. Unbelievable. 10 HP like that.
That was so greedy by CTY. Like, he had the Rupture, and that alone would have been enough to kill. But he decides to save it, and...
Oh, you're talking about with the pushback from the Spirit Breaker, right?
Yeah, if he just casts the Rupture at the same time as the Blood Rite, then they guarantee the kill, almost no matter what. But by allowing Sumail to roll out like that, once he got a little bit of distance, there's no way that CTY can continue to chase past that tower, right? So I think that, especially if you're against a Storm Spirit, you just blow everything. Like, you guarantee that this hero dies, so you don't have to deal with it at a later time. You're not going to get a lot of opportunities like that, because every time it fails, Sumail will just continue to farm out mid lane, and then once that second pressure fails, then you can just go to the jungle, because Universe isn't actually using the jungle too much, so Sumail can just abuse that if he wants, if he feels unsafe at all.
Yeah, this is a little bit curious. He went for the 3 levels in Sandstorm, so which is kind of a jungle build, but he's not actually utilizing the jungle. Why do you think that is? Why is he not just going, okay, I'm going to farm up the Radiant jungle, say, so he's still in this bottom area and just give the soul response to PPD?
The lane is too good for him right now, and I'm top. AUI is going to get caught out. He's dusted. This should mean a kill. And,
he just throws out the shuriken. Any bit of damage he can get out before he dies.
That's the I'm dead, but let me just bother you as much as I can. There's no reason not to.
Maybe this is another reason why they're really willing to run the Bloodseeker as a mid Radiant up against a Storm Spirit, is because he's Radiant side and he's able to utilize, similar to the SF, utilize those camps that are so nearby.
Yeah, I think that has a large portion of why that is. And they're going to make another attempt near mid. But
yeah, he gets a ball lightning jump. Mel got caught once and just barely lived. Keep a keen eye out for that Spirit Breaker, especially during nighttime.
E-Home's doing a really good job of pressuring him overall. I think if they hit that second kill, it would have been fantastic, but even without that, they're doing a good job of slowing down here, but they don't have too many counters for, which is the right idea. Like, just pressure him as much as he can in the lane, slow down his farm so he can't get a really quick Bloodstone, and just extend the game time.
They're gonna catch him this time around. The silence guarantees they get the kill.
If at first it doesn't succeed,
try again.
Nice. What synergy we have.
Yeah.
That was like the fifth time they went for it, and they're just like, we're just going to keep doing this. And Sumail's like, are you serious right now? Like, how do you justify doing this for the fifth time? But
this is actually comes back. This is a point that we were talking about very early on in some of our casts during the group stages, in even the wildcard matches. Razor and Viper, talking about Gyrocopter as well. Core heroes that are able to sit alone in their lane because they're either just tanky enough or they put enough offensive pressure on the offlane or whatever it is, right? They're willing to group three different heroes there in middle because why the hell not? Not RTK is going to be dropping low here. EG do make a big rotation out. Now RTK will go down the last couple right clicks, but at the same time, CTY comes in with a rupture. And King actually had to TP out because he was too low. Some mail still has a lot of mana though, and it's actually going to be a decision for the Razor, but there goes the heal off of Wana, but the damage from Fear is still enough. Now Samael is running out of mana, but he's still healthy enough to be able to battle off against CTY. Looks like Lana will be able to get the kill on Samael to start things off. The Tombstone is just too big, in fact, if anything. And UI's going to be caught as well. DDDC comes in from the side with a Hex. And that actually turns out to be a fight that I think Ehome won. It's really close. It was a 3-for-3. No, Evil Geniuses actually came out on top with golden experience.
Yeah, but it was still, I mean, that was perfect play by Ehome in salvaging that, because that could have been 10 times worse. The Queen of Pain comes in by Fear, perfect Sonic Wave, hits everything in its path, but then the Undying's there to get the putback kill onto the Storm Spirit, so you're just trying to slow down the Storm Spirit even more, and even with Fear getting those kills, it's not like his farm is insane. All he has is the treads right now, so Ehome is just doing a good job of minimizing the damage as much as possible. Doing a good job right now. They are leading in net worth, but that could all change since Universe has some jungle stacks to go to, and now that you realize the danger that bottom lane was just in, I think he's just going to be content upon the jungle now. Like before, lane was going absolutely fantastic, so he can just sit in the middle of the lane with Sandstorm, but in this type of position where it's worth it to make those rotations by Ehome, then he should be done.
You could see at level 7 he now goes for the epicenter because he is so close to his blink dagger. The first reveal of that blink dagger, who's your best option? Is it Bloodseeker?
Yeah, I think you go for wherever the Bloodseeker is. Going for the showing it off for the first time and just probably isn't worth it. The thing is, we can see the UI you just immediately go to the jungle whenever he falls back whatsoever and just makes quick use of this. Because Bloodseeker with treads and a Quelling Blade jungles so quickly. And we actually see this as well, is that Ehome decided to go for the smoke. They're trying to set up for somebody in mid because they anticipate Sumail coming in. And that's why you see the Lion and the Bloodseeker being the ones to smoke up and not anybody else. And YJ's going to push this in, and Sumail has no idea he's going to go for this
Silence on top, it's just a simple 1-2 combination. The Hex into Bloodright that kind of guarantees the kill on the Storm Spirit. All that extra damage and control is just excess from Ehome. So Evil Geniuses, they're going to need a lot more rotations if they want to keep this tier 1 tower ahead. It's talking about it just last game, last series.
Oh, they've got a blink and a smoke on Universe. This could be what turns it around for them here in mid.
Here comes the epicenter going straight for DG. The top PVD drops the chain thrust as well, which bounces over to the Razor. You cut it up for better luck there. ROTK controls Fear a bit. They do manage to get the Finger of Death to kill AUY. PVD run down by zombies, perhaps need some help from Universe. He will survive in the end. A 3-for-1, make that maybe 4. Yep, Samael jumps in as a Storm Spirit to catch Lanham at the tail end of the fight.
Middle tower is under EG attack. Are a type of lineup where if one person doesn't succeed, somebody does. In this case, Ehome did such a good job of shutting out Sumail with Cyclops and gank pressure that it was up to Fear. But then Fear got dual lane to top, so he was having such a hard time. And then so it's who comes in with the Blink Dagger. I mean, I thought he was just going to get one kill with the initial reveal, but with that smoke, EG demonstrate that they're willing to take a 4v5 fight as long as they have the positioning advantage. And that Lich Chain Frost bounce was so fortuitous. The fact that it went over to the Razor that had like 300 HP.
Right.
That was the dream fight for EG. The stars just aligned for them to be able to take that one.
At the same time, I feel like that was a lot on Ehome, just strategy-wise. That was a poor idea. I mean, they should know the Universe is getting close to his Blink Dagger to start with. But they also didn't have the mech out for the Undying. And that is a very critical factor in them winning these early team fights. I mean, they should have that mech advantage over EG. Because you look at their cores, none of them are going to go for an early mech.
Dire structures EG right fortified. Now, they are going to lose this tier 1 tower mid, but they're okay with the trade that they just had. Losing it, they're eventually going to give it up, but they got a 4-for-1 trade originally tower in the original attempt, so they're going to be pretty happy about that. It does mean that Lan M is going to grab his mech, but Ehome's in a really weird situation because they can't let that happen. Even if you have a mech, letting a Sand King get a multiple hero epicenter stun off is probably going to lose you the fight. Because there's so much follow-up. You can have the storm zip in, we saw the chain frost, you can throw the sonic wave, and on top of that, we didn't even see any track kills in that engagement because AUI wasn't quite level 6. If you make those mistakes against TG's lineup, you're just flat out going to lose him with Golden.
So you should never just 5-man into a tower.
You've got to smoke.
You got to smoke, get a pick off, and then take a tower. Or maybe if you have preemptive vision set up, such as the top lane, like this would be a decent tower to go for, only because they have that observer up. But it's only going to last for another 15 seconds, so hopefully this smoke is a little bit more fortuitous for Ehome. But we do have double invis, AUI as well as Smail. Both invis up, they pop the dust, but AUI and Smail hold that up in time. Now they're going to go for Universe, who plays his way to the side, Burrow strikes up our OTC, and now Smail will make it. Waiting for more of the Ehome to come into the cone area. Will bounce himself away. ROTK pops the ultimate out of fear, but is still put in a bad position by defensive play. Heal, but it's still not enough. The burst damage is there. Sure, now bouncing around over the lawn, and with the extra bit of damage from fear, they get another kill. The tombstone's all that's left for Ehome, except for CTY, who's desperately able to get this kill. Will be able to catch AY. Samael forced the TP out. The rest of evil geniuses will actually all retreat. CTY just gets one pick off. And between him and the tombstone, and evil genius is really just running out of steam, he will be able to kind of press offensively forward, but still a terrible fight for Ehome. Evil genius is once again winning.
I'm really surprised that after the smoke broke and ROTK saw the position that they were in, that they continued to fight them. They didn't have a ward in this sector of the jungle, and so that was just a complete blind fight for them. That was just them hoping that the power of the Undying Tombstone was going to be enough for them to take that fight. But more importantly than that, you just need vision. If you're against a bounty hunter and you're taking a blind fight like that, you're going
to be a lot of another jump from Samael, and that's a bounty kill as well. Not forget about the bounty hunter being a huge factor in these fights. Now three-man smoke epicenter lead the way. ROTK going to be jumped on for a strike up. He's tanking as all hell, but he's going to go down anyway. Evil geniuses just finding pickoff after pickoff. Snowball is a rolling at 15 minutes. It's funny because just like even 8-minute, 9-minute marker, things were looking really good for Ehome.
Oh yeah, they were doing so well. After they were starting to pressure that tower down, they had gotten a lot of kills, and I mean, EG were struggling, but Sumail, all of a sudden, he's almost got the Bloodstone, but I mean, I just want to highlight, them as a unit are moving around so well. Sumail opening up that bottom lane, being able to get that kill with AUI, at the same time, EG make the simultaneous move on mid, giving Ehome at no time to respond, and at bottom again, EDC is going to go down. This is another track kill.
And now they're well set up to be able to take this tier 1 tower as well, or maybe at least control it a bit. Ehome, they're already aggressively pushing forward with the Razor up in the top lane, who does seem to be going for an SNY build, starting out with the Yasha. We've talked about Razor builds before. We see a lot of mechs previously, but not so much anymore ever since the change up in the mech, and you already have a mech hero in Undying. Is SNY really the best option for a Razor, or is another build?
I think the SNY is okay, but he just doesn't have enough HP right now to live through the burst damage. Maybe it would have even been better for him to go for the mech. I think they anticipated Lawn-M having a better team, being able to get it a little bit sooner than he has in this game, because he had a really good early start, right? If we remember correctly, but I mean, ever since that early start, he was so close to it. I think I even mentioned when they took that tier 1 tower mid almost 5 minutes ago that he was only about 300-400 gold away from it, and now he's still stuck in a similar position where he now just finishes it after that tower at top. So this has been a lot more delayed than they would have liked, and at top, Universe is going to TP. Oh, this is such an awkward situation. Everybody from Ehome is set up.
That's a TP in from Universe, correct?
Yes.
So they may actually, I don't know, how do they catch him? If he just immediately sandstorms, they don't have any vision. And even if they did, if they ran forward and dusted, he would just immediately blink or burrow strike away.
Yeah, I guess he should be fine. As soon as he sees one hero there, things should be okay for him. But it's more just an unfortunate timing where I think he sees YJ right now and he knows that he's being backed up as a result of this, and you get to kind of just make your decisions based on the information that you can see.
Do you think YJ should have gone for, if he's going SNY, for the Sage first, like you see gyrocopters often go for when they go SNY solely just to beef themselves up earlier?
I think it would have been a decent play. I know right now he went for the Yasha first, but I don't think it's damage that he really lacks. Because CTY provides plenty of damage.
Sure.
I think it's just the HP, the raw health that he needs is a lot more important, because EG, their lineup does run out of steam after the initial burst, but it's that initial burst that's so strong right now that they're struggling to deal with.
Radiant's
and that's why you saw like Evil
Geniuses
make very clean escapes once they realize all their damage was out. Like in the last situation where they kill four heroes, right? Like most of the time when you kill four heroes and haven't dropped a single one, you're able to stick around, but CTY was able to take that bounty and the rest
Radiant's
of the EG back away,
because
it was like
fallen.
The Tombstone and CTY, that was too much for them to handle, even if they were a five-man.
This is the awkward situation that a bounty hunter pick puts you in, because E-Home want to fight because they have a Razor and they're dying, but if you get caught out by another tanking commit plus four or five-man tracks, the game becomes way too difficult.
Dire's
EG is just purely building heroes that can go into the late game. Sumail's got a Bloodstone already completed, so losing a fight here is pretty critical because they don't have the best way to get back into the game. E-Home doesn't have any real comeback mechanic heroes, and a lot of their heroes start to fall off after this point, and so when they go for this top tower push, they actually just have to
get the tower out, and they have to
do it cleanly, and it looks like EG aren't willing to risk it for this tier 2 tower just because E-Home is
Radiant's bottom tower.
So CTY is going to get a lot of farm out of this one. BKB is going to be his choice. Was there any other item that you maybe thought about? Perhaps like the blade mail that we saw from the last game?
No, because if you just get blind stunned by Universe, then if the Queen of Pain ults you before you can get it off,
Radiant's
which is really likely,
tower is
as
under
you've
attack.
Seen before, then you just lose the fight. And the chain frost damage, AoE from BG that you can't really risk it.
RTK making the charge down to the bottom lane. Fear does have AUI to back him up. And RTK, without much vision, doesn't want to make an overcommitment. Of course, that blind stun potential is still there for the option, right? I mean,
yeah, but it's the fact that you're hoping that your team can finally start a fight and then you can just run into the BKB blind. Because right now, the vision advantage is an EG favor just because they can control the jungle a little bit better than E-Home. So I think that CTY has to over. The problem, though, is that E-Home don't have the best catch potential until you have a Blink Dagger on your line. Like, if you look at their lineup, they pretty much have to smoke to be able to get a kill on anybody. Otherwise, they're just meandering around as five, as they can just split up the map and farm. Like, that's the beauty of having both a Queen of Pain and a Storm Seer, is that if you want to gank both of them at the same time, you can't really, because E-Home only has one hero that can really lock them down.
A little bit added utility. Universe is going to be going for a Yule Scepter after his Blink Dagger, so no like Force Staff or anything like that. It's probably a large factor comes down to the Bloodseeker and his presence in the game, but also just generally speaking, another stun is quite helpful versus heroes like Spirit Breaker.
Yeah, Bloodseeker is actually really farm. This is something I really like about CTY, is that he makes the right decisions as the game progresses. We saw him get SNY almost the entire day, but he realizes that this game, he can't just stick to that static build. He has to go for something like BKB to be able to survive. And I think once he grabs it, E-Home will be a lot more comfortable getting into a fight. Like, if anything, I think they should get into a fight. He's really their only flash farming character. Razor doesn't get that much stronger. He relies on being able to get towers, force heroes to go on him.
CG, they want to try and jump CTY in this middle lane. Lottom is sitting behind, I mean the whole entire team is sitting behind CTY because they know very strong chance. Both bottom and top lane are pushing. It's fairly obvious Evil Geniuses have got to be hanging around that middle lane. They don't really have a Roche taking team, so there's no other option but mid.
And it's so scary right now for E-Home because they don't really know what they can really get away with, because if EG decide to 5-man smoke, then they could just straight up lose the game. So they have to be really careful, and to their credit, they're doing a really good job. No one's being picked off anymore. They're playing 5-man Dota. The problem with playing 5-man Dota like this is eventually you do get out-farmed. Like, we saw it in the Seeker versus Fnatic game, right? It's not so much that the kills are overwhelmingly different, it's that one team is farming out three different lanes and their own jungle and your jungle, whereas you're grouped up behind a Bloodseeker because you're afraid he's going to get initiated on.
Fear casually just dropping the ultimate because he does have quite the early Aghanim Scepter. DDC is going to try and farm up. Do you go for Liberty first in this situation, or do you still try and go for the Blink Dagger?
I think you still go for the Blink. I think the bigger thing right now is they have to just smoke up and look for a fight. I've been saying it all tournament. If you're not waiting for another item, you know, you should just look for the fight because you're going to get off farm. So if you're E-Home right now, You've got the BKB. That was probably the biggest item that you could have completed, right? On your heroes.
Right.
YJ's about to get his SNY. He's actually got it.
I think he's going BKB.
Okay, he should switch, I think.
Yeah.
But
so maybe that's what they decided to lead on.
But as that stands, they have to look for the fight after the BKB, because they're just losing too much ground right now.
Yeah, you can already see it beginning to steadily climb. Net worth and experience are dropping lower and lower in just a very even pace because Evil Geniuses spread themselves around the map, farming efficiently.
Yeah, I'm not Storm Spirit biased, EG biased at all this game. I think Yihome played a really good early game. This is just what happens when the team takes map control. CPY might get initiated.
Samael follows it up. They burst it down so quickly. This is a problem with Bloodseeker. Just so tricky, especially when he's taking that level. Now RTK is going to be jumped on. He's got the bounty to get the extra movement speed for Evil Geniuses to catch up. But it's still the Spirit Breaker. Super tanky. He's going to make that jump. Sure enough, they're going to try and pump RTK. PC, they may as well be able to go for the Hex. Great side wave there. CPY is back. Samael first. They managed to lock him down, but a Bloodstone Suicide just at the tail end of that. YJ runs forward here, trying to go for
Universe from the back.
And from the side, Universe.
Oh no!
We got passed up at the tail end of that one. No Epicenter. The damage is almost there, but a Sandstorm is still not enough. They stun him up. Faker and Death goes in as well. AUY hoping to be able to get in Shuriken range, but that's not going to happen. CTY wants some more. But Evil Geniuses are healthy enough, won't be able to pursue. That was such a potential turnaround there. With Universe channeling that epicenter, his Spirit Breaker did not manage to charge essentially through him because Fear defensively blinked backwards. I mean, that was just happy fortune for Evil, essentially.
Yeah, that fight could have been a lot worse. Like, Universe waited in this area this entire time because he knew they forgot about him, and all it took was that Spirit Breaker running through to be able to get that.
Bottom tower is under attack.
Samael, calm down there.
Good fight, though, by Yihome. Like, they stabilize, for sure. Like, a lot of it, things fell their way pretty perfectly that the Spirit Breaker manages to catch him, but still,
Yeah. One,
you're not going to complain. One fight is one fight, so two for one in a situation like this, definitely worth it. And you're completely right. YJ's going for and I think at that point, Yihome say, enough is enough, we're not going to get picked off, we're not going to let you dictate the pace of the game. We're going to start to get on the aggressive, and that's the item that they choose to wait for.
Once again, though, the initiation factor is still there for Evil Geniuses. You still base all of your pushes around the smokes?
Yes, you have to, because if you just blind go up as 5, you're going to get Sand King ulted on. EG have all the time in the world to prep. You have to catch them from blind. It's not even that Sumail's that tanky. He's got a Bloodstone. He's going to go for the Orchid. Nothing like a BKB or a Lincoln, so killing him, you have the potential to do it. You just need to be tanky enough to live through the fight.
It's going to be another BKB probably coming from ROTK, but he's going to need a lot more time to farm, especially since it's a Spirit Breaker. He's not known to be a particularly flashy farmer.
Yihome is still in a pretty comfortable position despite what we were talking about earlier, because they know that EG can't really do the Roshan too early until they get probably a little bit more of an advantage. They don't have the best right clickers, so Yihome knows that if EG go for the Roshan, it's kind of unlikely. Maybe after a wand fight or something like that, but risking it before that point is worth it. So it's easy for them to kind of hold pace, because EG aren't taking any more effect. You're getting out farmed, but it's not monsters. It's just an overtime kind of thing. So if the Razor picks up his BKB at a reasonable time, which he's going to, he's going to be really happy. And we haven't even mentioned how big of a monster CTY is when it comes to farm. Despite Sumail being able to farm out the entire map, he's keeping it close.
Yeah, it looks like he's going back for an SNY, which he's seen multiple times. Unless he wants to go for the Manta versus Orton. Just out of the factor, like, he then hold on to his BKB for better scenarios.
I think there's too much AoE from Evil Geniuses for him to be able to do that.
Okay.
Like, they've got
that's
the,
a good point, yeah.
If you channel the epicenter and hit, the Manta illusions almost die instantly. Mm-hmm. So
SNY, just more stats built.
You just want to be able to take the initial wave, is what it is. You can't afford to just go for the straight Scotty. If you get initiated on,
what's
the point of having a BKB?
Don't tell me they're gonna go for a smoke. This is a ward placed by Evil Geniuses not so long ago. AUY, I believe, was the one who planted it. And they're sitting in this area like they've got a power. They're feeling like, okay, yeah, we're good to be able to smoke up in this area, but
there's the BKB on the Razor.
Yeah.
They're gonna feel pretty confident now, but at top, this is an overcommitment, I think.
Forward Fear, they have Universe sitting on the side. He does have his ultimate. Trying to make an interception here. Fear is silent tough. He's gonna go for the CP up,
17.
But there's the 17%. Fear falls. Orchid now complete on some mail, but they've lost their other intelligence core.
Yeah, I actually thought more. Oh, CTY Whoa. Just pops the BKB.
And what was that play from AUI? He actually showed himself popping out
they
near the tier 1 tower.
There. I thought Ichi was going to be prepared for that, but good play by E-Home. Like, they read the situation perfectly. They knew that it was very unlikely that Sumail could get there and get into that. CTY unfortunately popped his BKB, and that's now down to 8 seconds. So, if you're a fan of E-Home right now, that's got to swing a little bit. But 8 seconds is enough right now. Like, once it gets down to 5, it's going to be a little bit brutal. It just means that you have to win the next fight.
Yeah, let's talk about like late game interactions here a little bit. You give Evil Geniuses the late game advantage just because of the initiation and mobility once again.
I think I've talked about it before, and Storm's got a lot of counters, but Bloodseeker's not one of them. Like, Bloodseeker can't keep up with the Storm Sphere while it kills your entire team. E-Home just don't have enough heroes to match the mobility of the Evil Geniuses. He's got 3 heroes that can almost instantly get out, and Universe, Sumail, and Fear, and so once that happens, E-Home is going to have to rely on ROTK just going insane. He's got to bash pretty much every single hit to be able to catch everybody from EG.
Mm-hmm.
I played plenty of Storm versus Bloodseeker games, and especially in this meta, and Bloodseeker just can't keep up.
And that BKB is such a big factor. Like, 8 seconds is good now, but around 5 seconds. Like, what happens if they just kite him around for 5 seconds?
They've got a DD on their Storm Sphere, so they might feel comfortable. They don't know he's coming, actually.
Yeah, he's got the double strike. Maybe he gets another turn, but Sumail's already jumped in. He's a double man. Strike and Sonic right over the top. There goes one already down and out. Gazine is dead, and so too does Fall of Lion. YK trying to steal some of the damage, but he's going to run out of his BKB soon. 17% onto Sumail. The ultimate being popped as well. YK dropping lower and lower, but they need a couple more right clicks. No! Now the Berserker comes on to ROTK. They're going to be able to finish him off as well. CTY is desperate to get some cleanup here. They've already bought back on the Undying, but Evil Geniuses are just kiting around CTY forever. EG now to jump forward once again. First strike on Alana, throws out the Tombstone, trying to heal himself as much as possible, but with 3 heroes surrounding him, he'll just eventually be right-clicked down, and CTY is forced back from his base. Simply can't help out his allies.
That was maybe a little bit too optimistic to send your heroes in like that.
Mm-hmm.
I think if the Lion actually lived in the beginning of that fight, they could have popped Sumail a lot sooner, and maybe even win that fight where I just got away with a better trade than they did, but they gave up so many track kills. Sumail even managed to get the deny off him. EG don't even lose anything really for that fight. This is going to mean an Aegis for them at the same time. Hold the buyback on the end. CTY didn't really get away with anything, so it's not like he's going to be able to snowball as a result of that fight. Sumail's going to have to pick up an Aegis. Storm might just be the best Aegis carrier.
Oh. I think there's very little question about it. You can really beat out a Storm Spirit. It's just so versatile with the Aegis. Jumping in, committing to a kill on a support, and not really caring what happens after that.
But E-Home conceivably could have won that fight. That's what I still like to see.
If Lion had just like run, like you saw the Lion actually ran backwards.
Yeah.
For a second while he's in. If he just YOLO'd on in, he could have gotten the 2-man stun to set up the whole entire thing.
Yeah, that would have. I think that might have actually turned the fight for them and made it so they could have won that. Oh, CTY actually does opt to go for the Mantis stop, by the way, which I don't know if.
Yeah, I was kind of with you on your analysis of that one. I mean, that the feels like there's just too much. Too much AoE from EG.
Yeah, I would have preferred for him to just go for the stats. If you pop Manta at full HP, not bad. But if your Orchid is taking a lot of damage and then you pop Manta and your illusions come out with 300-400 HP, it probably doesn't make that much of a difference for EG to be able to select which one is you. Mm-hmm. Your farm out. They don't want to get into a fight with the Aegis. I think the better thing to do right now is EG is going to go for the smoke most likely to push their advantage, but E-Home is just waiting for the Aegis to fade out. With a minute left, they want to try to get aggressive, but EG is just not going to allow that to happen.
Poor man, smoke up. EG waiting for that perfect initiation. CTY is in the background too. perfect hero to go. Universe is smoked his pop. Looks forward to the side there. Might find anybody easy. Okay, they've seen the first one. It's okay, that's not really the hero they want to go for first. Good Sonic Wave. So now actually jumps from DDT in the back, but now he gets messed up. He actually is going to be caught here, but that's just the Aegis. And BKBs are going to be running out soon. That's why YJ runs for the last one. Trying to intercept Universe. All the rest of the team focus ends are going on to mail, but he's actually been saved by the Glimmer Cane. Here comes that epicenter. CTY's going to be the target easily for his death. Red team going for fear though. Samael jumps over, finishes off one. Here, man, takes a flick away on top of that one. Samael, right in the middle of all these heroes, but he's got enough mana to be able to make a long jump out. Now Universe comes back to the way. ROTK going for him on the left-hand side. ROTK starts going for Samael, but can't quite get him now. Intercepted by the Shuriken. And it looks like everyone else from Evil Genius has actually managed to get out. They lose two, and all EG drop is that Aegis.
If they had vision in that fight for Sumail when he got Glimmer Cape by PPD, they would have won that fight.
Yeah.
It would have killed Sumail right there, and they could have PPD to go through chasing.
Oh, wow. And
that would have got three kills.
He's only got a little bit more mana left. Last bit of all legs jump, but he gets caught on the tail end of the impale, so that one exchange, the bare hand exchange from him for ROTK is not worth it, but
Radiant's
big picture-wise,
Evil
Genius has definitely won that fight.
Radiant structures are fortified.
I feel so bad for Gihom because that's two fights in a row that just
Radiant's
if things
top
broke their way a little
attack.
Bit better, they could have won.
Yeah, they just had countervision. I mean, that was such a good plan. Basically utilizing the last couple of seconds of BKB and his natural tankiness runs towards the rest of the team, especially Universe, right? Like, he's trying to address Universe, trying to make sure that that guy does not get off a good epicenter, and the rest of the team just centers on the Storm Spirit. That was such a smart plan. In the middle of such a hectic team fight like that, they immediately made the right call. It's just the prep wasn't there.
When you look at EG's lineup, they don't actually have physical damage. It's probably their best physical damage dealer. Fear's gone for the Aghanim Scepter into the Lincoln. It's a pretty defensive throw that heavily centers around his ult. Sumail's gonna go for the Shivas, no Hex or anything like that. No Orc. He does have the Orc, I guess, but he's the main physical damage dealer. So if they're able to pop Sumail in that fight, get him out of the way, slow him down, and then chase the rest of EG, they conceivably could have won that fight. And in a pretty dominating fashion, too. Because the Razor's incredibly tanky. Same with the Bloodseer, he's got 2k HP with 15 armor. So they probably could have won that fight if you rerun that fight with just one sentry. Because they locked down Sumail, he was silenced, but then the Invis comes in, he waits out the silence, turns everything around for them.
To make a point clear, the physical damage, the reason to point out the lack of physical damage on EG is the fact that the physical damage is usually sustained, right? Like the rest of the magic damage that Evil Geniuses have, essentially you throw it out and you're kind of done. So if they manage to take out the sustained damage of the Storm Spirit, Evil Geniuses just eventually would have run out of steam in that fight, wouldn't have been able to kill as many heroes, and Ehome just would have steamrolled them from there.
You can't really mess up fights against a Bounty Hunter because things do just get more dire. The difference in net worth is now approaching 12k. The difference in XP is probably the more troubling statistic, is it's up to 15k right now. Again, Ehome. The chance is still there. The way that you should look at it is not the fact that they're down 12k, it's more that they haven't had a perfect fight, and they're still coming close. When it comes to the point where they have a perfect fight and they get stomped, then yes, that's enough for you to call it, but this is why comebacks exist, because Ehome can still get a better fight off than they have so far. Like, they can get better bashes on ROTK, they could kill Sumail in the beginning with a little bit more coordination, so I think that the hope is still there if you're an Ehome fan.
Aghanim's is the next choice for our Razor. Making it even easier. I mean, overall, I think we're going to like this build for Razor. His choice to try and go for the SMY first was maybe just a little bit questionable because they weren't far enough ahead, I think, at that point. But he opts to complete the BKB, go back to the SMY, and Aghanim. I mean, there's just so many stats here on this hero, and he's going to be a very good source of sustained damage. Evil Geniuses, if they can't pop him early on, if they're not able to focus him down, Razor's just going to tear the fight apart. If he can lock down heroes, that's a big problem. Evil Geniuses are incredibly mobile in these fights. They've got four out of their five heroes that have some sort of movement speed or jump. Track being given to everyone. Storm Spirit, Queen of Pain, obviously blinking, and then our Sand King with Burrow Strike and Blink as well.
AUI's got a Blink Dagger too, so the mobility of EG should not be underestimated. The key factor here is that if Sumail can get on top of the Lion, he would get rid of his biggest opponent off the bat. Like, a lot of what Ehome's fortunes lie in are how well DDT can position him. Because right now, he's doing such a good job, but this could all change here as EG, our setup
But do they think it's just a one-man stick on the team? They made a big jump straight for the background. Commander's taking out. He's running home ahead of the Resi E home. Arm popping their BKB. They're going to be able to lock down TPD. Does have that Glimmer King to help him survive a little bit longer. C2Y is actually looking for more kills. B plus does quite some havoc to E home. And E home is a one-to-one break. Top by TTY, and Samael's actually running low on men. They're gonna try and make a commitment for him. He just turned on to Samael. He's got a lot of armor things that will be able to get down. Yeah, but then wiping out the rest of E-Home, and they know he'll drop Samael. What a bait from the kid. My god, Evil Genius has just baited that E-Home out so beautifully.
Alright, Universe just. If there's an MVP, Universe has just played this game so well. His constant repositioning to get that epicenter off. It's the fact that he doesn't just use it when he sees the opportunity of Samael going in. He waited on the BKB, he's ever so patient. Samael trusts his team, zips in, takes all the focus on him, and E-Home, they smell blood. They're like, this is the fight we're gonna win. We're finally gonna kill
Samael. He's got no mana, but the thing is, I mean, he has Shivas, and even if he did die, he's still. EG cleaning the fight up perfectly.
Yeah, and Universe finally finds that opportunity for that big epicenter. And, oh my, did I even take this tower down? And that was so many track kills on EY. Just absolutely so rich right now.
Radiant's top tower has fallen.
Still need another 10 seconds for the Bloodseeker. They may actually be able to make a move and get the Anorax. No, EG back up. They don't want to take a risk, and I can understand why. They're so far ahead at this point. They should not lose another fight. With Epicenter down, BKB's coming back up for E-Home.
I was getting really excited for E-Home. I thought there was a point right there where it just felt like YJ couldn't die. And he was able to survive the initial onslaught. I thought things were going to be able to turn around for them, but that window of opportunity I was talking about where, you know, you're looking for that perfect fight that'll happen is slowly starting to come.
You also got to point out Samael's beautiful initiation to start all that off. Like, when they jumped wide shank, and I thought for a second, actually, that Evil Geniuses were being baited out by the Razor completely. They were just like, oh, let's just kill the Razor and back out. But EG, they knew E-Home was sitting behind that Razor, and Samael jumping in with the Shiva's active, way to the back, straight where the Lion was. Hit that Orchid on him and immediately popped him. As you said, like, killed the biggest threat to Samael.
That's the thing that you should always weigh as any type of mobile initiator is who does the most to you versus how much HP you get. A Lion has 777 HP, but he does so much to you. Why not just kill him?
Trying to move the Razor first here. Double BKB's activated to go for fear. Trying to lock him down, but the Glimmer came in. Blink away. He will be able to get some hits. TTY keeps on going. The Universe, he's going to pop the Epicenter. They actually control TTY and burst him down. Now the Epicenter comes in. But great for RTK. He's orchid up. He will go down as well. A lot of pop. But what factor is it really this way? Everyone else from E-Home is going to fall. GG win yet another team fight, and GG is the call. E-Home, I think, were just so desperate to find something, and team fight after team fight, they just keep losing and losing. They gotta know they're a drastic net worth behind.
The thing is, though, if you're E-Home, you're kind of okay with how you're playing, because you did set the blueprint for how you can disrupt GG's farmer. The gang Sunil locked in, they put the pressure on him early, they annoyed the hell out of Fear with that dual lane at top. And even that bottom lane, the Razor was doing okay. It was just about that one fight mid where everything started to snowball. And then from there, even the subsequent fights were still